All righty, welcome back for another episode of Two Plane Sports. We got a good episode. Well, not a great couple topics to talk about. There's some rumors going around with Ashton Cozart potentially visiting elsewhere, visiting Oregon this upcoming weekend. Could lose his commitment, which if you visit other people, you lose the, you're not committed. If he does go visit, I'd imagine we're going to lose him here pretty quickly. We're going to talk about some potential replacements as far as who could be the targets in the 2023 class as far as wide receiver goes, and then an update on Derek LeBlanc's recruitment. So, but before we get into it, we just want to say we really appreciate it. We're growing. And we're really rolling, and we passed that 4,200 subscriber mark. We couldn't do it without you guys. Keep spreading the word. Keep liking us on Facebook, following us on Twitter, Instagram, find us on Apple and Spotify, and make sure to turn on that notification bell if you hadn't already. Doing that, it's free. Taking the next step, it helps us out a lot, and it really helps us grow. So the first guy we'll talk about is Derek LeBlanc. This morning, I woke up and I saw his tweet. He, for anyone that doesn't know, he's 6'4", 270 pounds, 270 pound defensive lineman from Kissimmee, Florida, or as I once said, Kissimmee, Florida. He's a 2023 four-star, number 80 overall, number 8 defensive lineman in the class. He has visited OU already 4 times. He's planning on attending for a 5th time for the upcoming Champion Barbecue. His original commitment date was July 23rd, but he came out and basically tweeted, his commitment date's being pushed back because he needs more time. I'd imagine that means he's wanting to take his official visits this fall. I know he has an official lined up with Penn State, but that's the only one he's got on his agenda at this point. It seems like it's Penn State's kind of far back, but Florida and OU are the top two. And I'd imagine he's wanting to go for a game day, getting the full experience and everything else before he decides. And he knows that if he's going to commit to the Sooners, he can't be going to visit Florida this fall. So I feel like with him pushing his commitment date back, I feel like it's a good sign for OU. Because there's a lot of momentum with Peyton Kirkland and Malik Bryant, and they're all seem to be Florida leans, which OU is putting some work in on those two guys, and Kirkland will be coming back for the Champion Barbecue. I really feel like this is good news for OU. I don't feel like it's bad. Jose, what do you think?
Yeah, I'm going to agree with you there. I think that whenever you tweeted it out this morning, there were some people that agreed with you, some people that thought it actually was bad for Oklahoma because they felt like he was an Oklahoma lean, and this is just giving him more time to consider Florida, which I mean is definitely possible, but it seems like Florida's closer to him, right? Just that's we can't control that. And he's going to have a lot better relationships with them because he can get there a lot quicker. Just like Texas recruits and Oklahoma recruits can come to OU a lot more often than they can most other schools. But the fact that he needs more time, I think, is going to help us because he's got the official visit coming up. Or he's got the official visit coming up, right? And
No, it's unofficial for his fifth
okay.
visit. His official will probably be this fall.
Gotcha. So he's got his unofficial coming up. And I think it's fair to assume he'll probably take an official visit at some point, taking 6 trips, all funded by, his family is probably a lot, which if they can swing it, that's awesome. But, if they can take a free one, why not? So I think it's a good sign for Oklahoma. They just need to get some headway with Kirkland because it seems like those three guys were maybe not in it fully together as a package deal, but they were close enough where they might have a little bit of influence on each other.
Certainly hope it's good news. He's a huge prospect, great kid to get, great size. His numbers are fantastic. Friggin' 20 sacks last year or something like that. 65 overall tackles. Dude's a freak. We've talked to him multiple times on the show. I don't know what it means that he pushed it back. We'll see. Certainly hope it's good news for Oklahoma. He would be a huge addition to that defensive line.
Yeah, and Malik Bryant and Peyton Kirkland and Derek LeBlanc all originally intended to announce their commitment on July 23rd. As of right now, LeBlanc's the only one to announce that he's going to be pushing it back. Currently, Peyton Kirkland is slated to attend for a second visit back at OU, and there's been some recent momentum with OU going after Malik Bryant. There hasn't been a visit set up or anything like that, but he's a the 5-star in the 2023 class, number 2 linebacker in the class. If you see Kirkland, hopefully push his commitment back, because I feel like if that one happens, I feel like he's going to Florida as of right now, even with his upcoming visit. But if he pushes his commitment back, that could be really, really good for OU. So just something to watch. I hope OU can jump in the race with Malik Bryant, but I'm not, my hopes aren't high. He's a five-star number two linebacker. I mean, he's already got his relationships really strong, I'd imagine, at this point. So we'll move on to the next guy. This is someone we've talked about a lot, about his recruitment and then his commitment to the Sooners, is Ashton Cozart, 6'3", 180-pound wide receiver from Flower Mound, Texas, 2023, four-star, number 164 overall, number 22 wide receiver. He was going to commit to the Sooners basically right around Bedlam. Lincoln Riley obviously ended up leaving. And then quickly, Venables came in, hired Lebby, and then Cozart just jumped on board because he wanted to be a Sooner, and he was like a program guy. That's what it looked like anyway. Committed on February 4th. There's been some rumblings. I've seen some talks about potentially could OU lose him. And until today, which we're recording this on Tuesday, there hadn't been like an official report. But from Rivals, I believe, Nick Harris from Rivals posted that Cozart is reportedly slated to attend Oregon or go visit Oregon this weekend. He's originally from the Pacific Northwest, so he's got some connections back to that area. But if he's actually going to, there's been some conflicting reports saying that he's not actually going to do it. But if the guy from Rivals is coming out, someone has to be talking that he's going to do it. If he does intend to visit, I feel like it's going to be a Reed Mikeska situation where he announces his decommitment before the visit. So this is just me guessing and speculating. If he's actually going to go visit, I bet he decommits by Friday. Brandon, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. Ashton Cozart is a kid we're excited about, especially when you look at the receiving room after this season. We're going to have a lot of departures. He's a guy that would be really nice to have, and I'm certainly hoping that he does stay and doesn't take that visit. But with the way Venables kind of runs his program, similar to what Dabo does in Clemson, if he's going to visit, it's like you said, there's a good chance he's gone, which is a tough blow. It's something to keep an eye on these next couple of days, because I'm not going to sit here and act like that would hurt. Like, that wouldn't hurt, because Ashton Cozart's a guy that we've been excited for a long time. I think he can be really special. So it's kind of shit news, to be honest, but I guess we'll see how it plays out. But yeah, if he does end up taking that visit, it's over. He's gone.
Yeah. I agree with both of you there. It's like Brandon said, with how Venables recruits and his philosophy, it doesn't seem like it's a good sign for Oklahoma. And honestly, before we all hopped on, I was kind of thinking, like, do we need another receivers coach at Oklahoma? Right now, the only receivers coach is Cale Gundy. Before, with Lincoln Riley's staff, we had Cale and Coach, it was the Simmons?
Dennis Simmons.
Yeah, Simmons. And, you know, Cale is really good at helping come up with a game plan. I think that's been exhibited for most of his career at Oklahoma, and more recently in the last bowl game. But recruiting the wide receivers, at least so far, right now in recent history, this has been his last 5 month stretch, 6 month stretch has been the time where it's really, really him recruiting the wide receiver position. And it's not going as well as it used to, which doesn't, like, if you think back, if he was a big part of recruiting wide receivers with the last staff, it really shouldn't have taken that big of a drop off. I understand that players want to play for maybe a Lincoln Riley offense, but essentially it's at least one of two of the same receiver coaches that were still developing good receivers, but they're not coming to Oklahoma at least as quickly as they used to, which I get it. You know, some of them wanted to play for Lincoln Riley, which is, you know, it's whatever, but like, what is it that is making players not want to come to Oklahoma as quickly on the offensive side of the ball, especially wide receivers with Cale Gundy still here? I think there's just something there's something missing there potentially that may need to be addressed sooner rather than later, because how it stands now, like Brandon said, after next season, there's going to be a lot of departures and there's not a lot of depth at that wide receiver position still. And unless Venables is going to completely change his philosophy on the transfer portal and be really reliant on the transfer portal next year, I don't see it being a good sign for Oklahoma unless we can, you know, bring in maybe four or five recruits that just aren't really there right now. over the next like 2 or 3 months, because like you said with Malik Bryant, some of these kids have had relationships with coaches and schools for a lot of years now, and it's going to be really hard to come in and just put our names in there for top recruits, or even not even top recruits in all cases, just some recruits, because they've already really liked a coach or really liked a program and they're kind of leaning that way.
Yeah, and I think you bring up a good point. I think part of it is the fact that Gundy hasn't really had this role at Oklahoma, so there's a little less of a track record there, I mean, on his own. I think part of the equation is the fact that Venables, you know, once you commit, if you go visit elsewhere, you're not going to be committed to us, you know, you're done. I think that's playing a factor. But like you also just said, that if you haven't had a relationship with some of these top guys, I mean, some of them are being recruited as freshmen in some cases. I mean, OU's already on the 2025 class. So I think Gundy, he's a little bit behind the curve just because of the nature of the beast as far as, you know, building those relationships. I still think OU is going to end up with a couple 4 stars and maybe a 3 star or two in this recruiting class. I think Jackson Arnold is going to be able to either keep Cozart or bring in about 3 others. It's not the end of the world. I'm not going to sit here and say it wouldn't hurt to lose Cozart, because it really would. I think it's going to be okay. If we don't see good momentum in 2024 in a good recruiting class in there, I could see some issues and some things starting to rise. But I'm going to give Gundy the benefit of the doubt. And, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, you think about the last recruiting class with Lincoln Riley. What was it? Luther Burden, a couple other kids from South Texas. You know, it was full with the wide receiver talent. And these kids left before Riley and his staff even left. So just because you get the commits early doesn't mean you're going to sign them. So
that's true.
I don't know. So just kind of talking, the rest of the video we're going to talk about is potential targets. Even if Cozart doesn't decommit, these are 3 guys that are huge targets and very well could be Sooners. The first guy, I don't think we've really talked about him on this podcast, but I've read a lot about him, is Michael Harrison Pilot. He's a 6 foot, 190 pound safety slash wide receiver from Temple, Texas, 2023 4-star, number 100 overall. And they have him labeled as an athlete, so the number 9 athlete in the class. Just his stats last year, 20 tackles, 1 interception, 37 carries, 168 yards, 8 touchdowns, 29 catches, 484 yards, and 6 touchdowns. I mean, he was catching the ball. He was playing defense. He was all over the place, extremely versatile. OU offered him on January 24th by Lebby, Jojon Finley, and Gundy going down to his high school when they were going around right after the bowl game, and gave him his offer on January 24th. He came up to OU for junior days in March. Really, really enjoyed his visit. He's planning to come back for the Champ U barbecue. I think Harrison Pilot is someone that could hop on board relatively soon, and relatively soon as in the next few months. I think OU's in a really, really good spot with him. And you can't complain whenever the guy's got 14 total touchdowns, catching the ball, running the ball, playing defense. I mean, he's everywhere. So I'm really excited about him. Jose, what do you think?
Yeah, the dude's an all-around football player. As a receiver, he's got speed. Like he plays on the outside right now from what it looks like. And at his junior year, he played a lot on the outside, but he would still go down the middle and just avoid tackles. Like he's got the agility. He's got the speed. It'd be very much, maybe not CeeDee Lamb-esque, but kind of in that realm where he's got the agility to get out of some tough situations. You know, regardless of Ashton decommitting or not, I think he's a guy that needs to be a top priority for Oklahoma because of the wide receiver room situation right now. And he would add a different dimension, because right now, you know, Brandon's super high on like Jaden Gibson. We have Nick Anderson. They're all huge guys, like 6'3", 6'4", really good, fast kids. But this guy is in the 6 foot range, and I think he could keep up with the fastest guys on this team, Jaron Kanick or Jaden Rowe. I think he's got that kind of speed on him. And we, so he would add that second dimension to the offensive side of the ball with in the receivers, because it's not just going to be, you know, go up and get it. He'll be able to get around tackles and make plays on, with his feet.
I do agree he's a burner, and forget about just football, what he can do, obviously playing all literally almost ever on the field for his team. But he also plays track and baseball, so he's just overall just an athlete, just constantly busy, I imagine. He's probably somewhere in the outfield in baseball, just with his ability to cover so much ground and speed. And I do agree with you that he's fast. I think he's the second most important kid that we're going to talk about as far as priority goes. I think Cole Adams is coming up next is – the most important, but I have this kid ranked number 2. I think he's really, really good. I think he's a little slower than Jaden Rowe looking at his track numbers. Harrison Pilot runs an 11-something 100, and I think Jaden Rowe was in the 10, and so was Kanick. But yeah, I mean, that's when they're running side by side on a football field, you won't really see that separation until obviously the end or whatever. So yeah, I mean, he would be a huge get, a guy who can play multiple different spots for you. I imagine a lot of gadget plays you can run with him, sweeps, end arounds, things like that. It brings a lot of versatility to the offense. Can play a little defense too. Special teams, I imagine he could probably dabble in, especially in his early years of his career. I agree, should be high priority, and I just have him just behind Cole Adams, who's coming up soon.
Yeah, I mean, it's whether Cozart stays or not, I mean, you've got to press this guy and try to get his commitment. I would imagine if he has a good visit for Champ U, I think OU is making some really, really good progress. I don't know for sure, but I don't really think he's been visiting anywhere else. I think, you know, I'm sure he's talking to other schools, but I haven't really seen as of recent where he's been, and I might be totally wrong. And
the moment is that he's crystal ball to Houston. I don't know how much communication is happening there still.
I feel like he's going to – there might have been a little momentum, but I feel like all these other schools – I mean, there's a lot of big schools calling his name, and I feel like he's going to end up at a power – you know, well, I guess they are a power five, but going to the SEC anyway. So a terrific athlete, someone that OU needs to press and get regardless of what happens. Yeah, and you mentioned Cole Adams. We've talked about him a couple times. 5'10", 180-pound wide receiver from Owosso, Oklahoma. I can't believe we're still talking about this kid not having an offer. 2023 four-star, number 323 overall, number 43 wide receiver in the class. Another kid, versatile. Kick returner, punt returner, 18 carries, 180 yards, one touchdown, 55 catches, 913 yards, and 8 touchdowns. Brandon, I think when we talked about him a while ago, or when he visited, like on April 19th, You basically compared him to Wes Welker, which I totally agree with, you know, or even Julian Edelman. I mean, it's the same thing, basically the same role as that slot receiver. You know, Alabama, Texas A&M, LSU, and others have all offered him. His ratings going up, and I think his senior season, he's going to go up even higher. I really don't know why he went and visited, but yet he left with no offer. He should get an offer regardless of Cozart decommits, but say Cozart decommits, he's got to be the first kid you call. I mean, he literally has to be the first kid. You pick up the phone and you call and you offer him a scholarship. He should have been offered months ago, but you know, if you let this go any longer, I'm telling you, if it goes into June and you want him at that Champ U barbecue, because I'd imagine he's not going to show up for the Champ U barbecue without an offer. He already went down there. He, you know, the whole deal of visiting and then you get an offer and that type of rule that Venables and his staff are running, which is great. But if I were him, you got Alabama and LSU and Notre Dame and everyone else that wants you. And
in Kansas.
And yeah, in Kansas. Why wouldn't you go to Kansas? Why would you need to do that? You don't need to go beg for an offer. I just feel like if OU drags this out any longer, I mean, it needs to be in the next few weeks to offer them. They're probably going to regret this. What do you think, Brandon?
No, I absolutely agree. As much as we trust Venables, and I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say he's not going to build a great program, as much as I trust Levy, as much as I think he's going to build a great offense. Cole Adams not only is in your backyard, like literally the dude is 2 hours down the road. You can literally see him. And granted, to Venables in Levy's defense, they weren't here during football season. So I guess they did not have the luxury of being able to drive 2 hours down the road to see him. But now they do. They could literally go 2 hours down the road, see him anytime, work out or whatever, run routes, something. Or, you know, you bring him in again because it's not very hard to get a kid to come 2 hours. He's stamped, which I know I talk about a lot. It doesn't mean everything. But if Nick Saban wants you, there's a reason for that. So I don't know if Venables and Lebby see something where he doesn't fit in their offense or something. Maybe that's why. Because I truly don't get it either. Measurements-wise, 5'10 is a good size. You mentioned his ability to return kicks and kick returns and punt returns. He scored touchdowns doing that. He runs a 10.6 500 meter, so he's a little bit faster than Harrison Pilot that we just talked about. He's closer to that Jaden Rowe, Jaron Kanick speed range. Everything on paper, his numbers, what he's done in all of his high school career. I mean, looking at his numbers right now, the dude's got over 2,000 yards and 20 receiving touchdowns, 4 special teams touchdowns, almost 600 rushing yards, 7 rushing touchdowns in his high school career. Like, his numbers are there, his measurables are there, speed's there. I'm with you. I also am with you on if Oklahoma doesn't offer soon, if you're Cole Adams, you're not going to beg because, I mean, you've got offers from everywhere. So it seems like it's time to get on it if you're Oklahoma. And like, again, we're obviously don't get to hang out with this kid all the time. Like Levy and Venables might when they get these visits or where they see him fitting. Maybe that's the only reason he hasn't been offered yet. Because to me, it seems like a no brainer.
Yeah. Everything you guys said, I don't know what more there is to add, really. This kid is, he's not going to be a Sooner if these coaches don't make a move. Like soon. And at this point, like Alabama, just I'm looking at just like 247's roster of the schools that have offered him. Alabama's got 10 guys on their roster as of now. And now this doesn't include any commits for the 2023 class. So these are just guys that are officially on their roster. They've got 10 guys. So they would definitely need or want more depth at that position because they always produce really good receivers, especially in recent history. They put up a lot of NFL talent. So assuming that, let's just say 2 or 3 guys leave every single year to the NFL draft and then another 2 go just to transfer portal or graduation, they're going to need depth. Arkansas, they have 18, according to 24/7, 2 seniors and 3 juniors. A lot of those guys, if they have good seasons, will go to the NFL or be graduating or transfer portal. Like transfer portal is going to be an issue for a lot of these schools, especially with a lot of players like in Arkansas. 18 is quite a bit of people for one position. So I could see them maybe losing 1 or 2 guys in that room post next season. So that could definitely be a place, especially after they took Lucas out of Bixby. They've got ties to the Tulsa area. They're really recruiting there. So Cole Adams, I think, could definitely consider going there. And we can't just be waiting to see what happens with a guy like Ashnor or a guy like Harrison Pilot. And especially with the philosophy of this coaching staff that they emphasized when they all first came together, they want to keep Oklahoma kids in Oklahoma. Even if you don't see him fitting, he's still in high school. Like, By the time he gets to you, you can still mold him to fit your offensive scheme. He's not a finished product. He's not ready. He's not NFL ready. You can make him fit Lebby's offense so that he can succeed in college and hopefully make to the NFL in 3 or 4 years. But there's no reason why this kid shouldn't have an offer.
I absolutely agree with you, Hose. Like, if you don't see a fit right now, you can mold him to fit. I was just trying to come up with some logical explanation as to why he hasn't been offered yet, because it doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, that's the only one that would make sense. But again, there's no reason why he shouldn't have an offer right now.
Yeah, basically, if you're going to talk the talk about keeping kids at home, you got to walk the walk. You know, it's like you got to offer the kid. Maybe there's more to the story. It just doesn't seem.
What doesn't make sense about the whole thing is, yeah, you're right. We're talking about putting an emphasis on keeping these in-state talent product good, and I love that. But, and no offense to these players that I'm about to mention, but like Gavin Freeman, I'm sorry, like I don't see him at the same playing field as Cole Adams, and yet he's the guy that we prioritized and got to campus. The running back / safety from, I always forget this kid's name, the long hair kid.
Eric McCarty.
McCarty, yeah. Put up freaky numbers at his high school. Excited to have him too. But again, I kind of have Cole Adams ranked above him, at least on my, our 24/7 page here at 2 Point Sports. But like, it's truly baffling to me, and I think we're all in agreement on that. It's weird.
Yeah, it, there's got to be more to it. It just seems odd. It's just they're gonna have to do it now, or it's the ship's gonna sail. I mean, he grew up an OU fan, so it wouldn't even be like a hard recruitment either. The longer you wait, the harder they're making it on themselves.
Maybe they're, like Brandon brought up a good point, maybe they're trying to do, and with Gavin Freeman, it was a little bit of a different situation because the coaching staff came in late, but maybe they're just expecting these kids to like take a bet on themselves and bring him in as a preferred walk-on for a year before he can get a scholarship. Like, that's the only other like somewhat logical explanation I can think of right now because of the point Brandon just brought up. But still, like, I agree with you. This kid has got the talent, and he's even if you don't want to listen to the Two Plane Sports big board, you can go to the 24/7 Arrivals big board, and they have him ranked over some of the kids that we're currently recruiting. So it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, I don't know. Something to watch. I hope to see him tweet out, receive an offer, and then hopefully some great momentum starts. So something we'll be keeping an eye on. We'll get off our soapbox. We'll move on to the next kid is Anthony Evans. We haven't ever talked about him. He's 5'11". 155 pounds from Converse, Texas. You want to talk about a burner. 2023, he's a three-star, number 646 overall, number 87, a wide receiver in the class. He originally committed to Arkansas November 25th, decommitted on April 22nd because he got an offer from OU on April 15th, returned for the spring game on April 23rd, and then we'll take an official visit on June 3rd, OU for the Champion Barbecue. And he only has one other official, and the only other school he's looking at is Georgia, which is the following weekend on June 10th. His stats last year, 15 carries, 115 yards, one touchdown, 35 catches, 491 yards and three touchdowns. He ran a personal best 10:27 100 meter dash. The kid is a burner. I think that's what a lot of these schools are seeing in him. Is, could he be the next Hollywood? I'm not saying he is, but that speed, that weight, that size screams Hollywood to me. And it seems like it's between OU and Georgia. OU's pushing hard for him. I feel like OU's in a really good spot because he's coming up on June 3rd. And that means he'd be on campus three times in the last 6 weeks. Brandon, what do you think?
I mean, that last part's definitely good. Kind of like we talked about with Piscotty, although granted we whiffed on him in our initial reaction video about Luke, about Piscotty, because I think all three of us on this show sat here and said Penn State and Oklahoma were going to be the two, you know, finalists for him, and then he dropped to Final Four the next day after the video and Penn State wasn't even on there. But that's off topic. The reason I bring up Piscotty is because I think the reason we're in such a good position with him is because of how frequently he has visited the University of Oklahoma. And you just mentioned with Anthony Evans, his third time in 6 weeks. I don't know, boys, like if you're going out to eat dinner or whatever, you don't go to one place three times in a month and a half. If you're not like, damn, this food's really, really good. You know what I mean? Like if it's average or mediocre, you'd be like, yeah, that was good. Maybe we'll try it again in a year or something, you know, not in a huge rush to get back, but it's like, damn, that shit's pretty good. We're going to go three times in a month. That's a good sign. I kind of try to compare all this football recruiting news to real life stuff. I would bring up the girlfriend thing a lot, and now I'm venturing into the restaurant game, but it's a similar concept. I think just anybody visiting that many times, coming back over and over again, is a good sign. And as you mentioned, good numbers, good size, really fast, plays two sides, or plays offense, plays running back and receiver. Damn. You know, to bring a lot. It's definitely a target to keep an eye on. Hopefully it works out for us.
Yeah, he is not just fast, but he plays physical too. He kind of, when I was watching his tape, he kind of reminded me of a, you know, younger Tyreek Hill, the way that he goes up for the ball. Like, he's not scared to get hit when he's in the air, which when you're that small is pretty impressive, because even as a football player, you're probably still thinking in midair. If you see one guy in front of you coming to hit you at the stomach, and you think that there's a safety coming over top to just try to smack that ball out of your hand, it's got to be pretty intimidating. Like, you know, you hear these defensive players all the time. He heard footsteps, or I got, you know, I got him thinking, or something like that. Like, he's not afraid. He's not a guy that's going to be intimidated by potentially getting absolutely obliterated by two defensive players. He'll go up and he will grab that ball and come down with it, which I like. Like, outside of just him just absolutely toasting people, he will go up if need be. So I hope he commits. I think that his recruiting rank right now is probably going to go up. I think his senior stats hopefully get better, but he's a guy that's got a lot of potential with how, not just how physically and athletically talented he is, but it seems like he's got a mentality that can definitely propel him to be a special player.
Yeah. I mean, it's the fact that you can run that fast in junior year, you know, his junior year, he might even get faster senior year, might put on a little weight and still keep that same speed. Just because you're a little smaller doesn't mean you can't be a star. I mean, we've seen it firsthand here at OU. So you guys have any final thoughts? Kind of sucks to talk about what we talked about, but I mean, that's the nature of the game, and that's recruiting's is the long game. What do you think?
It wouldn't hurt Anthony Evans, right? I'm getting the name mm-hmm. right. It wouldn't hurt him to, you know, throw in a couple sandwiches in his meal plan just to bump up to 160. But
yeah. Brandon, do you have an indie video challenge for the people?
For sure, man. So it's conference finals time in basketball, which is a fun time for Rome and I to be a part of. We have been going at it. It's fun, especially the Eastern Conference Finals. He's wearing his dumbass Celtics shirt. I got the Let's Go Heat sign going here. We've been watching these two teams play each other since high school, you know, back to the LeBron era. So this is obviously fun for us. I'm a Heat. He's a Celtic. I think the Heat are going to win the championship. I'm sure Brum thinks the Leprechauns are going to win the championship. It's, you know, it's a bunch of garbage, but they suck. But so there's a two, I guess there'll be two end of video challenges for you, if you will. So if you're a basketball fan, out of the four left, Miami, Dallas, Golden State, Boston, who do you like and why? What is your finals matchup and why? If you're not a basketball fan, if you think shooting hoops is a stupid sport, we mentioned restaurants. What is one restaurant you would go to 3 to 4 times in 6 weeks? You know, is it whatever? What's the restaurant?
Brandon, I know it's McDonald's for you.
Dude, I can go to McDonald's 7 times a week. Realistically, I could, but that's just horrible.
Because you literally did.
College. What do you say? Where do you guys – we'll ask you guys first, and then we'll let the people comment tomorrow – or today, I guess.
Jose? Oh, you're muted.
Restaurant, I'm going to go with Chipotle.
Chipotle, of all restaurants. That's
yeah,
the
it
one
seems pretty basic. But it's the easiest thing to do. Kind of healthy-ish, depending on how much you get. I kind of overeat it every time, but, you know, whatever. And then for my finals matchup – on the Western Conference, I'm going to go with – I hope it's Dallas, but it's probably going to be the Warriors. But so I'm going to go with Dallas just because that's who I hope it is. In the Eastern Conference, ideally, we somehow don't play Game 7 and you guys just end it in a draw and Dallas just wins the championship by default. But since I have to pick, I think the Celtics are going to pull it out in 7.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. As far as restaurants, like – I would say Chick-fil-A. I could eat that 3 times in 6 weeks. I mean, it's great. And a finals match,
like a steakhouse or like an Olive Garden. Or something.
I mean, like I was thinking, like Charleston's
Chili's
is a good one.
Applebee's.
Wasn't your pick yeah. McDonald's?
No, Brum picked McDonald's for me.
Yeah, I would say Chick-fil-A. I mean, but if you're going a little nicer, I think Charleston's is always really solid. I could eat that 3 times in 6 weeks. And I think it's going to be the Warriors and the Celtics in the finals.
Heat and four in the Eastern Conference Finals, Heat and four in the finals. We'll see you guys next time.
See you guys.